A very good morning to you, Trinidad and Tobago. This is Karyn. Thank you for tuning into PSA Radio, the station that continues to keep you informed and entertained, and the station that is the voice of the people. A very special morning indeed. We've got some guests with us, and we would like to strongly suggest that you tune into ustream.tv and type in PSA Radio in the search bar. And that way you can see and hear us live here at PSA Radio. Remember, this is the oldest union in the region and the only union with a radio station that gives its union members a voice to air their grievances live for greater global awareness. So this morning we've got guests that are gracing us with their presence. To my right, we've got Mr. Leonard Baldwin. And to his right is Janela Rodriguez. And they are here with the CSO, or the Central Statistical Office, and they're here to talk to us a little bit about the restructuring of the Central Statistical Office. And so I would like to thank you both for joining us this morning and start initially with Mr. Baldwin. So Mr. Baldwin, share with us a little bit why you're here with us this morning and what you're here to share with the audience.
Well, we want to speak about the restructuring of the CSO, an initiative of the government of Trinidad and Tobago, which began sometime in the 90s and actually got flowing around 2005, 2006. Prior to that, the government of the day had decided that the CSO should have executive status. We weren't certain about what executive status meant to the CSO. The staff was most concerned about it, and we asked for a meeting with the Director of Statistics so that he would explain to us what was meant by this executive status for the CSO. Apparently, the executive status came about in discussion with the government of the day and the IADB, who had promised to fund this executive status that the CSO was supposed to be attaining. Now, when we had the meeting with the Director of Statistics, he explained in a way the sort of options that are likely to be looked at in terms of what sort of module will be the new CSO, how it would be restructured. What we discussed with him is that we were not, as a staff, we were not prepared to have everything being thrust upon us with no input from the staff as a whole. So we asked him to form a committee comprising management and staff, which he would chair, and let's sit and discuss this proposed restructuring. One of the things that he spoke about, which we as the union, you can select one or the other, but there were six models that the government could follow in terms of restructuring the public service. At the time, the selected agency, the guinea pig, so to speak, should have been the licensing office. Well, what we did convene the meeting across the board. So when I went to the meeting, I suggested that we break up the 18 people into six committees. Because we had several sessions, when we would have looked at all six options, we would then discuss a hybrid, possible hybrid for the CSO, or decide which option we found to be most favorable. Well, we did that, but we didn't just decide, well, look, this is the way we have to go. We took notes, and while in the process of doing that, the Ministry of Public Administration, who were overall guiding the whole initiative and the whole exercise of public sector reform, indicated to the Director of Statistics that they had the terms of reference of some consultants that will come in. Well, first of all, we knew that consultants were being, they were looking at the consultants. And we also had looked at the sort of persons out there who were offering, or who could possibly offer advice as to how the CSO should be restructured. And one of the major persons who we identified based on research was Stats Sweden. And, well, of course, the Ministry of Public Administration, all of us were on the same head with regards to that. So Stats Sweden were, in fact, selected to come in. They offered to train and restructure and give advice in accordance all over the world on the statistical research and data and offices and so on. And so we knew that it was Stats Sweden coming in. And then the director indicated to us that he had received from the Ministry of Public Administration the terms of reference of the consultants. And he began to read them. And then we said to him, no, we're not happy. We're not happy with the terms of reference. We would prefer, because he couldn't answer the questions, the public admin were the only people who could do so. So we asked that public admin come and meet with the committee and explain to us and hear our views as regards the terms of reference. You see, we didn't want to be caught up in the process as the IDC and the TITCO, well, what eventually became TITCO, it was, I forget the name they had, Tourism something, and the IDC and the, there's another one that was in Salvatore Building. They were all there, and the government combined all of them into what is now TITCO. And they had no forewarning, and the staff had no input whatsoever. We knew about that, and the other place was the Management Development Center. And I was heavily involved in the union and so on. I knew the problems that the people had across at IDC, and I decided, look, our staff is not going to court, so to speak, off guard. We're going to make sure that we're prepared and not allow them to shove anything down our throats. Now, the reason why they're able to shove things down your throat is when you have done no research. You don't know anything. You have nothing to counter or to present as your views. We weren't falling into that. We were going to meet them square on and let them know we have researched this thing. We have information. We have views. And we need to be heard. And graciously, the Ministry of Public Administration apparently, it was the first time they had, you know, encountered such, and they were very pleased about it. And two people came down very graciously and sat with us, and they were pleasantly surprised as to how organized and prepared we were. And in fact, we were able to get them to change a few of the terms of reference that they had. One in particular had stated that the when the consultants came, and they began to do their meetings with staff, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, they would meet with the permanent secretary and the director of statistics, the permanent secretary and his staff, and the director of statistics. And we said, we ain't happy with that. If he has to meet with the director of statistics, we want that changed to the director of statistics and his team. Because we had in the CSO what we call, apart from the committee dealing with all of this, we had, it all emanated from the fact that we had a joint consultative committee in the CSO. And the joint consultative committee dictated things in the CSO. And having said that to him and to them, the selected persons would come basically from this extended committee and the joint consultative committee. But it couldn't be a big side, so to speak. So eventually, we agreed with the terms of reference, with the few changes that were made, and the consultants came. And from the word go, when the consultants came, we had decided that the director of statistics, of course, he's the main representative, the main spokesperson for the CSO. But in addition, we will have with him the chairman of the staff side, which was one of Janelle's predecessors. And I had by that time retired from the public service, so I could not be officially included on the CSO's team. However, the parent body here, the union, recognized the input that my work on this stuff and asked me to represent the PSA on the Stakeholders Advisory Committee, which was set up. Government set up a Stakeholders Advisory Committee, and the Director of Statistics, Chairperson of the Staff Side, representing the CSO. And then we had the current Director of Statistics, who is now Mr. Clement, who was basically the resource person working with the consultants. The committee was chaired by the Permanent Secretary, and it comprised people from representatives from the Ministry of Public Administration, the CPO, the DPA, the Central Bank. In fact, the governor of the Central Bank, the deputy governor, was one of the Central Bank's representative. Then you had the Ministry of Trade and Industry, you had the Ministry of Labor. I'm not too sure if health was there, but all of those stakeholders who do statistics. So we had a nice big committee chaired by the permanent secretary, and we met constantly with the consultants, and the CSO's input was very important. I was able, as a representative of the PSA, but in fact I was doubling, because while I represented the PSA as the parent body, I mean, I had been in the CSO since 1964. So I knew, and in 1973, I became chairman of the staff side in the CSO. So I was intimately involved in every single aspect of the CSO, apart from knowing its history and relating its history to the current as we went along. So I had a tremendous input, and I must say the input of the union was very well respected by the other people around the table. They had become accustomed to what you would call in the olden days trade unionists who just opened their mouth, talk big and loud, and had nothing particular to offer. And they even remarked about that, you know, first time they meet trade unionists who articulating positions. However, it worked fine for us, and we were able to get to impress the consultants, because remember, they're basically strangers, eh? They would know about statistical office and the restructuring, but the actual culture of the organization and the country, they were not aware of. And we were able to make them aware of these things, make them aware of what the problems are with the CSO that need to be corrected in order for the restructuring to work. So we got a draft report from the consultants, and we looked at the draft restructuring, because when they did the draft, they were back in Sweden, and they sent the draft down to the permanent secretary, who had a meeting with the Stakeholders Advisory Committee. We looked at the draft and we saw that basically everything that we had advocated or requested or decided on was into the draft report. And there were some salient features. By and large, we found in the CSO, the CSO has had a history of poor leadership, very poor leadership. And we had lamented that fact on many occasions when we suffer drastically at the hands of the authorities because of the type of leadership we had. One particular area was that attempts were made to restructure the organization before. In one case, we had Mr. former deputy director, Mr. Lance Busby, who had put up a nice draft. But because of what I would call the relationship between the director of statistics and the authorities was not good. We had a director of statistics who used to call a spade. He was very, very firm as regards the type of CSO that he wanted. He was very strong and disciplined, and he and the technical ability of the department. And he proposed, Mr. Busby proposed a restructuring under his jurisdiction. And because of the fact that that director and the authorities were at loggerheads, the organization suffered. They put that report into the mothballs to get dust and never bothered with it. And consequently, the organization suffered. As a matter of fact, even now as we talk, the last time that the CSO was restructured was in 1972. Last time. And that was the last time that any posts, new posts or additional posts was created in the CSO.
So who is the person that is inspiring the change or the restructuring?
As it stands,
is there a key person that is bringing this on?
Well, the key personnel, well, first of all, they will have to employ what you'd call a change team or change manager. That has not been decided upon yet. Because what has happened is that that initial report of the consultant, the final report of the consultant, dealt with basically the physical structure of the CSU. What sort of directors we'd have, what areas we would cover in a broad sense, what were the type of, one of the things we asked for example, is that the senior personnel in the department who are at managerial level must not only have qualifications in statistics, but must have managerial qualifications because they have to manage an organization and so on and so forth. So those are the sort of things that we have to put in. The consultants, they have returned. And the meetings have started with them last week, Friday. We had one at Crown Plaza of stakeholders. There's a follow-up one on Friday coming. And Friday, they will be presenting to us the proposals for the new CSO. I don't know if you want to say something about that, Angela.
No, I think it's the organizational structure of CSO.
Yes.
Appealing to the people starting of the new organization. And we, the PSA, will be meeting with them before that to talk about the organizational structure of CSO.
Yeah, well, basically, this is what it, because, you know, yes, you have the restructuring, but when you reach the stage where you have a, you have proposed a structure, a module, which is what basically we did. There's also the Statistics Act, which is the legal aspects of the thing. Data collection and so on, you need to have some form of legality. And there, since we are broadening the perspective of the PSA, as of the CSU, the legal issues have to be expanded and gone into deeply. So we had proposed, the consultants had indicated, well, they don't know anything about the culture, so they can't deal with that. We have to handle that. So we did make some suggestions, and it went to the legal people to do the legal drafting of the document, the Statistics Act. It's still there. When that is completed, that has to go to Parliament for approval. Because, by the way, Cabinet has, the former Cabinet in 2006 accepted the final consultant's final report. So now the Statistics Act eventually have to go to Parliament. And also, what the consultants dealing with now is things like the organizational structure. They have to look at the training needs, the staffing needs, the type of staffing we're going to have, what qualifications people need, how many of them, what sort of appraisal system, rewards and sanctions, compensation packages. All of this is now is what they have to make proposals for. And when that is complete, I would assume that the first thing that will have to be done, which we had suggested, is that we need to bring an HR personnel on board. Because HR personnel will actually have to get into the nitty-gritty of things and come up with job position descriptions and all of that. They will, the consultants will attempt some of that, but I would not believe that that will be the final product. Because in actual fact, that will have to be gone into much deeper because you remember you're starting at the lowest level to go up to the highest. I don't assume now what the consultant's going to go into all of that in detail. They may go into it at the level of the highest people. And then, of course, you know. But it's a long exercise, and one of the things that is of tremendous concern is that if we have to have a properly structured statistical agency, as they propose to call it, which will be interlocking with all the various stakeholders who will be producing statistics as a sort of governing advisory body in handling national statistics as a whole. If we want to do that in a professional way, in an efficient manner, using all the latest statistical techniques and having the well-qualified staff that you're going to need with a training program that is ongoing and doesn't stop, we're going to need money. It's going to be expensive. And that is one of our major concerns. Will the political directorate, would they be prepared to put out the type of money that is needed to have such a statistical agency functioning? Now, one of the proposals that we probably would want to make is that if we can't have financing for the whole hog, so to speak, we may take a leg, we may make a pork leg or a shoulder.
Take an extremity.
That's right. And when that is in place, the next time we cover a little more, and so on and so on. So it's an ongoing, growing process. So that 4, 5, or 6 years, we have the complete thing in place, doing all that it's supposed to do.
Now, Mr. Baldwin, just interjecting for a minute. What is the reason that the consultants are coming in from Sweden, as you mentioned? Do they have a reputation of being some of the top dogs in the world, so to speak, for being able to pull something like this together?
Yes, that Sweden is internationally acclaimed as one of the top people in terms of an efficiently run statistical office with the type of expertise. In fact, those consultants, most of them were formerly working with Stat Sweden, but they have this sort of agency where they have gone into this sort of agency to do statistical advisory all over the world. And they offer their services as an international body doing this.
Okay.
The other agency that we had sought to get involved with was Stats Canada. But there were too many complications and so on with that one. So, you know, because we were hoping to have both of them, different working in different aspects. According to Mr. Clement, he had indicated that, and Mr. Clement is the current director, he had indicated that, you know, there are too many complications to have to get both of them on board. Stats Canada, there were a whole lot of things that you had to go through. You couldn't go directly to them and ask them to come in. You had to go through all sorts of protocols and so on, which were not practical. So we settled for Stats Sweden, lock, stock and barrel.
But before we move on to Ms. Rodriguez, Mr. Baldwin, you are walking, talking encyclopedia from my interesting point of view of union business. And I feel it's important that the audience recognize the history that you have with the PSA, with the union, and tell us a little bit about your involvement with the union and how you came by being so knowledgeable about so many aspects within union business. Just to give us a little history before we go on to Ms. Rodriguez.
Well, you know, when I throw back to 1970 did a lot of things to Trinidad and Tobago. A lot of the things that were done to Trinidadians and Tobagonians in 1970 are not
that was
very,
the time of the Black Power movement,
correct.
Was it not? Yes.
That's right. A lot of the things that happened and a lot of the minds that were changed and so on were not recorded and were not known, still not known. But I was one of the persons in 1970 who had a lot of changes in my own thinking. And in 1970, I decided to enter Cipriani Labor College. And I spent 4 years doing afternoon classes in industrial relations and labor law and all these things. I graduated from Cipriani Labor College in 1974. It was a long period. But prior to 1970, just before 1970, I became a member of the PSA. I entered the Central Statistical Office in 1964, and I entered the PSA. Just so routinely like everybody else. But I found myself with a great interest because I had come from a background when I used to be in a CYO, Catholic Youth Organization, where I received a tremendous amount of training, which made me, for example, I learned to speak in public speaking, impromptu speaking, debating nationally and otherwise. So then the research began to clock in, a research mentality. And having joined the union, I became a member of the General Council through the Statistical Officers section at the time. And I remember in 1970, I got statistical training, and a whole group of us at the end of the training approached the director of statistics to find out what he has in mind for us. We now trained and we look for positions. And he indicated to us that he had proposed a restructuring of the CSO reorganization. And he had called in the union and he gave them a copy to study. But he got no response. So that set me off. And I went to the management of the section and I indicated to them, well, listen, what is this restructuring about? The director told us that he had proposed certain positions and so on. He passed it to you all and he got no comments. Then they said to me that they looked at the document and he wanted it back by 4 o'clock in the afternoon, so they gave it back to him. I said, so well, you didn't find it was necessary to call a meeting of the staff to let staff know what's going on? And they got upset. So in the course of that meeting, when they got upset and they decided, well, look, this is the end of the meeting and they're leaving. And everybody was getting up to leave. And I got up and I said, no, we can't leave. This meeting is not over. If they want to go, let them go. Let us elect a new chairperson and continue the meeting. So they then elected me as the chairperson. And the first thing I did is pass a vote of no confidence in this executive. And we kicked them out of office. That's when I became chairman of the Whitley Council, which is what I preceded the joint consultative machinery in the public service. And then in 1973, joint consultative committees came into effect. But between that time and 73, I was a member of the General Council of the Union, under my mentor was the late, great James Manswell, who I used to go and see 6 o'clock, 6:30 in the morning. I would go come to James' office, right? The little come down the little side there and sit down and talk with him and tell him about certain things going on. And then James will inform me. He was an encyclopedia himself. James will inform me, well, no. And so time the CPO passed a thing and he would go and get that copy of the circular and show to me. And I was able to learn. And then I, on the General Council, listen. In those days, we had great debaters in the General Council. And I would sit as a youngster in the General Council there and listen to these people, see how they do things, chat with them. Then among my personal friends, based in the neighborhood and so on, there were people like Clive Nunes, who was a stalwart in the TIWU. And then being at Cipriani Labor College, I met a whole lot of budding trade unionists who were active. And all of this knowledge, information, grounding, built my knowledge. And I became more and more involved in the PSA at General Council. And then when Dr. Rennie died, again, I was on the General Council right through. And when Dr. Rennie died, I was approached.
And Dr. Rennie was one of the former presidents of the Public Services Association.
He died tragically in a car accident.
Yes.
Roland Graham, who was his first vice president, was elected on opposed as president at a conference in San Fernando, and I contested the first vice president position with Gwendolyn Louis-Lance. And in very good faith, there was never any bitterness between myself and Gwendolyn. We both wanted the positions, and we both spoke to one another, and on the day in question, I won.
Wow.
I and Gwendolyn remained good friends. We never had any animosity. I don't see
So you were the first vice president of that time?
I became the first vice president.
And that was from when to when?
Well, interestingly, we only had 10 months in office.
Really?
Yeah,
Why was that?
that was this, in election year. Elections were in November. We came into office somewhere around January, February. And there was very little that we could have done in that period of time because we didn't have any group as it is to say now. We were two individuals.
Yeah.
And when the elections eventually came, that turned out to be a tremendous negative for us because the other party that contested the election had people like the Deputy General Secretary and the General Secretary of the Union in office.
Mm-hmm.
And because Mr. Graham was a, what you call a first vice president at that time, was not a full-time position. It was a part-time. So the only time you came to the office was when they had our executive meetings.
Tell me what that year was again, please.
I think that was 91. If we go back every 4 years from the year when Duke became president, we get to go back to about 1991, somewhere around that time, I think. And so we lost the election. I conceded very early in the night that we had lost the election. But notwithstanding that, I remain active in my union because I am of the view that the union stands firm. All the machinations and all the discrepancies and all the disagreements and all the bitterness that come about at election time is just by the way. When the election is over, the union remains intact. And I said to myself that I am going to be it. So I went immediately to the new elected president and offered my services. I think it was Jennifer. I went ahead for this. And then when Jennifer became president, because of my training and experience in the union and union matters, because as chairperson of the staff line, I got involved in a lot of industrial relations matters, grievances I had to handle. Then my training in Cipriani Labor College, where I graduated from, my exposure to the general counsel all those years, and as a mentor of James Manswell, and listening to others. Then in addition to that, I went in 1981, 82, I got a government scholarship to go to UWI in Jamaica to do a certificate in public administration. And so I got that. And tremendous training in CSO that hadn't have me research oriented in statistics. And when I put all of it together, then I went in 2001. I got training as a trainer of trainers in the performance management and appraisal system for the public service, which coincidentally, Roland Graham, the ex-president of the PSA, had been employed by the CPO, personnel department, to come up with this new system and put up proposals for how the system would work.
And the CPO means what?
Chief Personnel Officer.
Thank you.
And his this department was responsible for setting up the performance management system in the public service. And the document that they use is still around as a sort of Bible of the system, shaping performance. And I got involved, I was trained by him, and then I was asked to train the same people who I trained with in the consultative machinery in the public service, because I had set up the first consultative committee in the CSO in 1973. I remained active in it. I got involved with other consultative committees throughout the public service. So I knew the problems they had intimately, what problems that you get when you want to set up these sort of committees, the feedback you get from management. So I developed that expertise from 73 to the current. And the personnel department, the chief CPO at the time is Sandra Marchak. I used to go around with herself and Mr. Alkins, who was head of the Statutory Services Commission, to speak to permanent secretaries and their senior staff about the importance of joint consolidated machinery and why they should set it up and how it's supposed to function. Ms. Marchak was at the time pushing for me to get a, what you call it, to come back into the personnel department as an officer responsible for working with permanent secretaries to set up consultative committees. That fell by the wayside after she left. It reached the stage of the minister at the time, and that was it. But I remained with the knowledge all the same. Mm-hmm. So the union took it up, and Ms. Batiste used to have me come in and during the training programs for branch officers and so on, and have an input by speaking to them about consultative committees, both in North and South. And when she demitted office and they demitted office, Mr. Duke took up the mantle and now has me employed as a consultant in the field of performance management and joint consultative committees. So under the auspices of the union, I'm able to go into ministries and departments and impress upon them that they need to have the performance management and appraisal system in place. It's the law. And that they must comply whether they like it or not. And if they don't comply, there's a price to pay. And so I try, of course, to avoid having to have them pay that price by using persuasion and telling them. Sometimes I have to put my foot down and say, well, listen, this is the law. If you're not complying, this is the way we're going to do. And to date, we have started to take some of these matters, quite possibly they would end up in the public service tribunal. And that basically, with little things in between, has been my history in involvement in the union. Now, one of the things is that I'm known by and large throughout the public service for lots of reasons, not only because of my involvement with the union, but also when I started off in the public service, you would go to training sessions at Central Training Unit. You go there as a young statistical officer, but you would meet administrative people from different ministries and departments. That is one of the things that was so important for communication in the public service, but it's gone by the wayside now. And as you move up the ranks, they move up the ranks too. You're able to visit ministries and departments. We used to have at one time something called Ministry of Finance Sports, where all the organizations under the Ministry of Finance, Treasury, Inland Revenue, Customs, Head Office of the Ministry, CSO, Town and Country Planning, all these divisions, Valuation Department, had one massive sports meeting down at the PSA grounds. It extended for a week, where we had all sorts of indoor activities, all fours. It was fantastic. At that time, the PS was Mr. Frank Basotti. And Mr. Basotti used to take the march pass, and I used to go to him and say, well, look, you know, I was one of the secretaries of the committee. The chairman of the committee were, at that time, eventually became the head of the Accountant General, Ken Henry, and his wife, Wilma. And, you know, all the people in the Treasury and all these departments, we all knew one another. And so, you know, people know you in the public service. And so whenever I go to any ministry or department, I usually would find people who know me. Those who don't know you, your reputation goes around. Thankfully, I have to say, I don't know. I have to say that I seem to have a good reputation. But people will come to me and say, you know, you don't know me, but you have been highly recommended to handle my matter for me. I want to get your advice. Up to just now, somebody called me, oh, I don't know. She said, I understand you are the expert. I said, well, I don't know about the expert, but you can come back and I'll see you tomorrow morning. And so it goes all through the public service. I cherish my integrity. I'm not a eater food person, and I will never be a eater food person. My father was a head teacher in the colonial days, where you had to have integrity, because in any community that you live, the three important people were the parish priest, the sergeant of police, and the head teacher. And my father brought us up. He didn't want to hear anybody complain about his children. But I also grew up in an environment where the head teacher was in a sort of chief cook and bottle washer. My mother's house, which was always near to the school wherever he taught, was like a haven for the teachers. Teacher not feeling well, they come across to my mother's house to rest their head, get something to eat, something to drink, relax. Children, similarly, they come by my mother's house to get ice block, some food, say the equipment, assist. And as my father, when he did come home in the afternoons and on a Saturday morning, he would go to Port of Spain to handle matters concerning the school. I was always, during the vacation time, parents in and out of my home, complaining to my father about their son or daughter, what is advice and assistance. And I saw my father was virtually running all around the place, not for matters concerning him or his children, but for the people who, and sometimes I hear him relating to my mother, well, you know, so and so and so, he have to do something concerning the child, because the child. And in that environment, probably it had
an effect.
Had an effect.
Yes.
And it's not surprising, therefore, that I have that concern, same concern, for people who can't help themselves.
Yes.
And I believe it is part of the reason why the good Lord put you here and give you knowledge and experience. If you cannot put it to the benefit of people, then you might as well not be here. No point in being educated and then you don't pass anything on, you die with all your knowledge. That's not me.
Well, Mr. Baldwin, I'm sure that well stated and well articulated, by the way.
Thank you.
On behalf of everyone in the PSA, the union members, and of course the persons that you represent, I'm sure everyone is very, very thankful and very grateful for your presence and for your service and for your knowledge, wisdom, and understanding. And you know, we really, really appreciate the time that you offered to spend with us this morning and the audience to share great information about the Central Statistical Office. And just moving along a little bit to Janella Rodriguez.
Janelle.
Yeah. Okay, but I said Janella.
Could I
My apologies.
Say one word about Janella. You know,
yes, please do, Mr. Baldwin.
Very early o'clock, we had been in the search in this year, so I had been personally looking around for somebody who I think could take up the mantle. And I saw in her, because when Janelle came to work at this year, so I was one of the persons on the interview panel that interviewed her. And I saw something in her at that time which perhaps nobody else saw. I knew she was involved. She used to play Pan with Invaders.
Mm.
And to me, that was a significant point. Because a lot of other people, they get education, they come to work, but they are not involved in any sort of community activity. So they don't know how to deal with people.
Right.
So I saw that immediately in her. The second thing I saw in Janelle, she appeared to me from the way she came across, her body language and so on, is that she's a no-nonsense, committed type of individual who has integrity. And I must
That is rare today, eh?
That's right. So before I actually zeroed in on her to become a member of the staff side, there were certain incidents that took place that confirmed to me that she's the right person.
Mm-hmm.
So I approached her and I said to her, Janelle, I want you to come to see me. She didn't give me right away that, yeah, coming into this thing. Again, which is something that you have to look at. So she said, well, listen, I am willing to come in, but I don't think I'm ready to hold any office or anything like that. I said, that's all right, you come in and I will help you. And she came in and she started to serve. And she ran into some problems because of the position she took, and she stood up to people who were playing the fool. And then I said, Janelle, you know, happened? We want you to be chairperson of the staff side. And here she is today, and I'm not disappointed.
What an introduction was that. That is awesome when someone with Mr. Baldwin's background and expertise in union business can say that about you and make that presentation about you. So in your words, Janelle Rodriguez, tell us a little bit, tell the audience a little bit about who you are, what you do, what's your role, and how are you in terms of, where are you at now in terms of functioning that role and executing that role?
Okay. Janelle Rodriguez, I'm the chairperson of staff side, Central Statistical Office. I came into the Central Statistical Office as a temporary clerical assistant.
I have worked in business surveys as well as national accounts. So I have been trained under some statisticians such as Stephen Corbin and Tyrone Gopal. In terms of like how I got into the union business, it really wasn't my thing in the beginning, because you come into an organization, you come to work, I really didn't know much about the union. And when
how long
you realize,
has it been that you've been in this role?
In terms of the union?
In terms of what you do? And the
I have been at CSO for the past, I would say, 11 years. Yeah. And during that time, you go through a lot of, besides work experiences, you go through a lot of challenges. And yes, Mr. Baldwin saw that potential in me, but I didn't know that I had it within myself. And when you realize that people are not really able to stand up for their rights, or not strong enough to stand up for their rights,
you have to be the voice.
You have, yeah. And sometimes, because it's new to me, it's a challenge, because you see things going on and you wonder how people are not seeing, and you know, why are they not standing up? And it's just that they don't want to be that voice, right? The staff side that I have, they're a very strong team. This is going to be...
So this is the staff side of the Central Statistical Office.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay.
This is going to be my third year as a chairperson.
Well, congratulations.
Thanks. And we're very committed in what we do. You know, I try to tell them that it's not about us. It's about for the betterment of the organization. So we have had a lot of struggles. And where I am now is basically going on strength to resolve some of these issues, because these issues have been long outstanding. And if you don't pick up or develop that strength to have the courage to stand up to management, you get nowhere. This executive at PSC, they have been very, very supportive. And, you know, when you think sometimes you are down and out with regards to getting nowhere within your organization, you always have the executive to depend on, and they give you that strength to move on. So that is basically it about me at this point in time.
Okay. And so where are you in terms of your role? How do you feel that things are progressing? Do you feel that there's a standstill? There's regression, there's progression?
I would say snail pace progression. I would definitely say that, because as I said, 3 years into this job, you know, you think you're not seeing anything. But I think one of the things I've learned during this process, it takes a lot of patience. It takes a lot of determination. And it takes, you know, you have to really have it within you to know that, you know, sometimes things are not that easy. You can't, you know, you have a problem that existed for years and you can't just get over it and get rid of it at one point in time. There are a lot of challenges that you have to go through. So it's progressing at a snail pace.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, you know, we're going to take a radio station break at this point, and of course come back and have our audience continue to be with us and continue to join us. And so we're taking a break right now, and we'll be back with Mr. Leonard Baldwin and Ms. Janelle Rodriguez with the Central Statistical Office. It's approximately 4 minutes to the hour of 10. I'm Karyn Rudd, your host, keeping you company right up until 1 o'clock today. And then at 1 o'clock, Dr. Mike will step in and take over the reins from 1 until 7 p.m. So we're taking a break at this moment from PSC Radio. Remember to tune in to ustream.tv and type in PSC Radio in the search bar. And that way you can see us and hear us live at the radio station. And this is the radio station of the oldest union in the region and the only union with a radio station that gives its union members a voice to air their grievances live for greater global awareness. So keep it locked on the PSA Radio. Remember, if you've got a smartphone, that is an iPhone, an Android, or a BlackBerry, you can download the app called TuneIn, T-U-N-E-I-N, and simply type in PSA Radio, and virtually take us with you wherever you choose to go. And of course, we're always pleased and happy and glad and contented that you continue to choose PSA Radio as the station that continues to keep you informed and entertained, and the station that is the voice of the people. Keep it locked on PSA Radio.
This is Malia Dillon, Vice Chairperson of the Dental Assistance Section of the Public Services Association of Trinidad and Tobago. The dental assistants say congratulations to members of the Public Services Association on your new radio station, PSA Radio. This radio station represents the voice of labor, in particular,